Welcome to the Album Anniversary Podcast. Today's show is about Throwing Copper by Live, which was released 30 years ago on April 26, 1994. I'm your host, Caleb, or Caleb the Spy, on Twitter and Instagram, and every day on those social media sites, I post about what I call album anniversaries. And I try and do a regular weekly show, and during that show, I just recap the week and talk about, you know, a lot of the albums that I engage with throughout the week, and just go into a brief, you know, whatever, explanation of what I thought about it, what I liked, what I didn't like, that sort of things, and just kind of talk about some of my favorites from the week. During the regular show, it's super fun to have a guest, but I've also found it's really hard to get a show out in a week, and I talk about so much music that it isn't always conducive to having a guest on the show. It's really hard to turn it around, and I end up being up all night, and nobody wants that. Well, I don't want that. So instead, I've decided to do kind of more of these one-off shows, just a chance to talk with somebody about an album that they love or that has hit them in some way or they just find to be special. So like I said at the beginning of the show, we're going to be talking about Throwing Copper by the band Live, and I'm joined this week by Kevin. Welcome to the show, Kevin.
Hey, it's great to be here. I've been following you for a while, been interacting with you on Twitter, and I'm just pretty stoked to be doing my first podcast ever.
Yeah, well, I'm glad to have you. I'm sorry it has to be my podcast. That's really unfortunate because I barely know what I'm doing.
No, I love it. I love it. I'm super excited about this. Told people at work, told my family. Now I'm looking forward to this.
That's awesome. Well, that's great, man. And like you said, you know, we kind of connected through Twitter. I'm assuming it was through kind of the what we lovingly call the hashtag CCM Twitter. Is that kind of where we connected, you think?
Yeah, that's definitely it. I don't know how it came up. I guess thank you, Elon, for the algorithm. Who knows? And we'll talk about later as well, even though we're talking about Live Throwing Copper. I'm obviously a huge CCM fan. You know, grew up on that and still listen to a lot of it now. And followed your stuff on Twitter. Really enjoyed interacting. Even if some of your hot takes on Jars of Clay, I still love it. It's all good. But especially you being a Five Iron Frenzy fan, we can dive into that as well too. But no, that's how we definitely connected first. So I'm really excited to finally get to do this and talk about some albums and album anniversary.
That's awesome. Well, so you kind of mentioned it, you know, you're kind of a big music fan. So, you know, what's your connection with music in general? Like raised in a house that listened to a lot of music or played music, you know, kind of where was your first kind of connection to just music in general?
Sure. So, you know, first 10 years of my life, lived on a farm south of San Antonio, Texas. Music was a big part of my, a bunch of us lived on the same 100 acres, my grandparents included. Old piano in the house, gospel music, old, you know, church music. So I grew up being around that. My aunt played piano. My dad played guitar and sang. So being around that really inspired me to want to pick up music. And what's funny is the person who I really listened to the most music with is my mom. And while she... You know, she sang in the choir and all that stuff. She didn't play any instruments. But when I was in the second grade, I won a contest in class and won a Rich Mullins tape. Hey, wow. Kids, before streaming and CDs, we had these things called cassette tapes. You had to you had to rewind them. It was a real pain. So anyways, the album was Pictures in the Sky, and I wore that tape out. So Rich Mullins was my first musical influence, first favorite artist, listened to that all the time. That kind of opened the gateway to things like Michael W. Smith and so forth. But my mom kind of raised me on the Beatles, Simon and Garfunkel, and then my dad and my grandparents, you know, the old gospel and country western and so forth. So music always around, instruments always around. So yeah, that's kind of what started that journey.
And then that clearly started to the connection to CCM was a Rich Mullins tape in class. Was this like a Christian school or was it like just a, I mean, that's a really interesting award for a classroom setting.
No, great question. It was actually a school called Mount Olive Lutheran School, which sadly I don't think is around anymore, but it was a Lutheran school in San Antonio, Texas. I forgot how I won, but I won some contests and my teacher gave me this tape. I was like, cool, I'll check this guy out. And at that time, Pictures in the Sky was actually his old album. He was already the Awesome God dude.
Okay.
So I already knew him from that and then dove into his music. And as I grew as a musician, we'll talk about that in a little bit too. He was definitely an influence on me musically, but a lot lyrically, and just kind of his philosophy on his faith in life and so forth. And as we talk, it actually kind of comes full circle as we get through the conversation. It's quite interesting.
That's pretty awesome. I'm not going to lie. I wish I never won much at school, but I wish it would have been a Rich Mullins tape. That'd have been way better than anything I think I ever won at school. And so then you mentioned the idea of like instruments were always around. And I'm assuming you learn. I mean, did you pick that up and learn to play stuff?
I did. And this is where it kind of almost comes a little full circle here with Rich Mullins. When I was about 12, we moved to Window Rock, Arizona, which happens to be the Navajo Nation capital. My dad's job got us stationed out there. He was an RN in the public health service and worked at the federal hospital out there.
Okay.
I went to a little school called Hilltop Christian School. And at that time, I was really wanting to learn guitar.
Hmm.
My math/science teacher, a guy named Todd Newman, who I still talk to this day. He's a mentor of mine. We met every Wednesday for several weeks, and he refused to take money, so my mom made him pumpkin bread. Kind of funny. So he took desserts, and we jammed for about an hour or two every week, and I practiced on guitar, this little cruddy classical guitar, and eventually got a old Franciscan acoustic guitar and played. And I met my friend named Cody, who I still talk to thanks to Facebook. He was big into music as well. Talk about him. He was definitely my 90s alt rock influence, and that's where Live definitely comes in. But
yeah,
here's where it comes full circle with Rich Mullins. I'm in computer class one day. See, kids, before we had laptops, we had desktop computers. And we had Oregon Trail week that day, once a week. So anyways, I'm in computer lab. It's taught by our coach, and I was on the basketball and the baseball team, and he was asking me about music. He's also the guy, Jim Mishevitz. He's the one that, another mentor of mine, introduced me to MXPX and some of that side of CCM. And so he's asking me about my musical likes. I'm like Nirvana, Pearl Jam, all this stuff. And then I mentioned, oh, Rich Mullins. He goes, oh, he lives across the street. I said, okay, guy, sure thing. We're in the middle of the desert in the Navajo Nation Indian Reservation. Like, very desert. And I've been to Iraq. I mean, it is desert. And he takes me out and says, no, that's his little one-room trailer right over there. I said, are you serious? And then I think a couple days later, Rich Mullins just happened to be at chapel service, and there he was. He always had a heart for the native peoples of America. And that's who he wanted to be around. That's who he wanted to minister to. And that's where he really felt drawn to. So I met him, his collaborator towards the end of his life, Mitch McVicker. It was just really cool. Not too many people get to meet their heroes.
Yeah.
And I can honestly say I got to meet mine. So I grew musically. I continued to, you know, play a lot of music, just me and my friend Cody jamming a bunch, learning, you know, from my mentor, Todd Newman. And that's, again, where kind of my Venn diagram of music comes together. I was, you know, love the CCM stuff. I love the 90s alt rock scene. Once upon a time, I had hair and it was down to my chin. And that's kind of where that is. And we eventually moved back to Texas, joined an alt rock band. We started a band called Scattered Souls. And it was actually, it came from the, kind of a blend of you know, the parable of the seed scattering and being fruitful and growing.
Yeah.
So nothing too crazy. But we recorded a couple albums, used to play all up and down the I-35 corridor, Dallas, Austin, all that good stuff. Just had that post-90s grunge sound to it, but a lot of spiritual undertones to it. Because while, you know, I never hid from my, you know, who I was as a Christian and so forth. So that definitely played into our songwriting and playing and nothing crazy. We played for about 4 years and then people grew up and went on and did other things. But I still play.
Okay.
I'm currently in education and an Army reservist, but even when I was deployed, took my guitar with me, had a lot of jam sessions with my my superior, because he also played guitar in Iraq. That was pretty cool. And just all sorts of other kind of cool places that my musical stylings have taken me. And I still gig here in the DFW area as well.
So okay.
Little acoustic stuff here and there. But yeah, so about 30 years strong doing that.
That is amazing to have, you know, stumbled across Rich Mullins. Is this difference between like going into a concert and like, you know, talking to the band afterwards and just like, oh yeah, he lives across the street. That's incredible. That is totally incredible.
I feel very fortunate for that situation. Of course, obviously tragically lost his life and that hit me pretty hard. And it's cool that people like Cademan's Call and even more so Andrew Peterson and CCM have really, and I got to see him in concert a few months ago here in Dallas. So, you know, they continue to kind of, you know, let his legacy live and they play a lot of his songs and so forth. And Mitch McVicker still tours. And if you haven't checked out Mitch McVicker, he's released a lot of albums, but his debut one, that's a no skip album. It's so good.
Cool. Well, that's awesome to hear. I'm glad to get to know you and get to know you better. And if we come to another Rich Mullins track or Rich Mullins one, I think I'd love to have you back on because it feels like that could really be there could be some depth to his music added to the discussion. So I'd love to have you back on for another time for that. But that out of the way, every Sunday I try and post what's coming out this week or that I'm going to post about this week. And you had messaged me about talking about Throwing Copper by Live. Let me go through a little bit of history and stop me when you want to add stuff. Throwing Copper was released April 26, 1994. So celebrating a 30-year anniversary. And I think, like I said on my show recently, my goodness, 1994... pretty solid year of music, in my opinion.
Oh my gosh. Holy cow. We could do a whole podcast just on 94. Weezer.
Yep.
I think there's a Pearl Jam. Hootie. I mean, come on now.
Pearl Jam. Green Day's Dookie.
Oh my gosh.
There's so many. It's like every month there's a big, important album, in my opinion.
Oh yeah.
It's crazy.
Absolutely. And this is definitely one of them.
For sure. So this was their third album, which I would guess a lot of people don't know. I think a lot of casual fans would assume this is their first, but it was actually their third. And they had been playing together. This is why I found out they had been playing together since the early 80s in some incarnation of this group. And this came out in 1994. So that was like middle school. I will say that was pretty young, but they've been together for quite a while in some incarnation. In 1991, they had a single, it's called Operation Spirit, that went to number 9 on the modern rock charts. Have you ever heard that song?
I do. It's from the album Mental Jewelry. It's a good album. There's a couple of good songs on there. Operation Spirit's definitely one of them. Probably my favorite one on that one.
Okay. I'll total honesty, was not aware that they had a hit before this album came out. I was like, oh my goodness. I had no idea. So learning, I am learning as I go here. And then Jerry Harrison of the Talking Heads, that I love the Talking Heads. They're one of my favorites. He produced their second album as well, but he also produced this. And I think this is the biggest thing he's ever produced. A couple of the other ones that I think are worth mentioning is the Verb Pipes Villains, which included that song The Freshman, which was a big hit.
Great album.
And then the Julian Theory, their album Love, which I think they're a CCM favorite by a lot of people.
Yeah, they would have probably started the CCM emo scene, I would say, late 90s. So yeah, love me some Julian Theory as well.
So I thought that was an interesting connection that Jerry Harrison had produced that one as well. A couple of things about Throwing Copper itself. The cover art is a painting by a Scottish painter named, I'm really good at pronouncing stuff, Peter Housen. And it's entitled The Sisters of Mercy. And then, Jerry Harrison produced this one. And, I tried to look into, like, kind of the recording process. And I couldn't actually find much outside of, I heard a mention, I watched a video about the history of Live. And I think part of this was recorded in Minnesota, actually, where Nirvana had recorded In Utero. I'd have no way to verify that, but some other random video that I was watching mentioned that. So I was like, oh, that's cool. I don't know if that's true at all. So if I'm lying to you all, my bad. And then this, I'll say it, this album was a monster sales-wise. So it sold 8 million copies, 8 times platinum, by far and away their biggest selling record. I don't think anything's even close. So
no.
And then 5 singles. I'm not going to go through them all. We'll probably get to them when we talk about it. And 3 music videos. So that is a pretty full album, in my opinion, to get 5 singles and 3 videos out of an album. I don't think too many bands do that at all anymore.
No, not at all.
And then, you know, just one other note, like just after this comes out, they are all over the place. The appearances on MTV's 120 Minutes tour. And then they also were at the famous Woodstock 94. And I have the Woodstock 94 CD. It's just a bunch
of... You have the double CD?
Yeah, I do. I do. And they have a song on there. I believe it. I want to say it's I Alone, but I could totally be wrong. So
think so, yeah. It is.
So they were also at that the famous Woodstock 94 as well. So, all right. That's some of, that's some of my history. I don't know anything else to add from a history perspective.
With this album, I can dive in here a little bit. So what's funny is I was talking earlier about, you know, living on the out in the middle of nowhere in Window Rock, Arizona. One of my good friends, Cody, his parents managed a video rental store. See, kids, before we had streaming videos, we had to go rent things like cassette tapes. Again, you had to rewind those. And his parents would get these monthly packages of the new music videos coming out. Hmm. And one time, he just happened to give me one, or we were watching his house, I can't remember, and it was Selling the Drama. As you can see, was their first single from that album. Yeah. And that video and that song got me hooked. Just, I mean, talk about three or four chords and, you know, just some good lyrics. And it was just a catchy chorus. I really appreciated the, I loved Pearl Jam at the time. And Ed is talking about pronouncing things. It's a hard last name, Kowalczyk. I'm going to go with Kowalczyk.
That sounds right.
Ed Kowalczyk, the lead singer. If Eddie Vedder was a tenor, that would have been him. You know, he's more of a baritone, but very a lot of vibrato, very strong voice, high range, and that song was just really good. And I loved just the way they even record, even before I recorded stuff myself, the way they recorded the acoustic guitar in that song just really drew me to it. So more of the story, that's how I came to know Live, was watching that random package of new music videos coming out, and here was Selling the Drama on that package. And I was like, I like this song. Where can I get this CD? And bought the CD, and I wore that thing out.
Yeah.
So, you know, it harkens me kind of back to my, you know, early alt-rock days. Came out in 94. You know, like I said, you had the explosion there. We talked about some of the other big 94 albums. In hindsight, I would say if I had to compare that album to anyone, like I said, gives a lot of Pearl Jam vibes. These guys are not from the West Coast. They're from Pennsylvania.
Yep.
So you had a little difference there. No California, no, obviously, Pacific Northwest. But, I mean, if you would have put them on tour with Pearl Jam when they did Vitalogy, this would have been a solid complimentary opening and main act, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Both those albums are very good. So that's how I kind of came across Live, was really with Selling the Drama. And then being a fledgling guitar player myself, a lot of their songs are really simple.
Hmm.
Only a few chords. I mean, Lightning Crashes is all of three chords.
Hmm.
And we'll dive into that, but I mean that's obviously their biggest hit.
Yeah.
I mentioned earlier I still play, I still gig. Typically covers, right? No one wants to hear my originals. I go play the covers to people. It works for the tips. But Lightning Crashes is definitely in my repertoire. It's three chords, and everyone knows the words, everyone knows the chorus.
Yeah.
So yeah, that what makes this album special to me is definitely one of my first. Big 90s alt rock albums that almost a non-skip album. There are a few tracks that I kind of felt like were fillers or meh. Maybe I like them, appreciate them a little more. I'm older, but at the time when I was 13, not so much.
Yeah. So you mentioned the Pearl Jam. I think it's interesting because I think they would say REM is one of their big influences. And so, like,
I could definitely see that.
Hearing
sure.
that as I listened back to it, I was like, oh, I feel like I can hear it. Like, it's not the same, but it also makes sense. Like, because REM, I think, was unique because they get roped in with the 90s alternative stuff, but they were doing, you know, they were around 83, 84.
Well, before that.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And they also feel like from a unique location, right? They're from, I think, Athens, Georgia, but they're from Georgia.
They are.
You know, Pennsylvania. Sure. So I feel like that's might have been even a. Just another connection for Live, because they've talked about REM as an influence, and I can kind of see that now, like kind of listening to this and knowing, especially not Lightning Crashes as much, but some of those other singles, I feel like I can feel the REM influence in them, and I thought that was an interesting comparison or kind of to hear them talk about that. So,
you know, especially from the vocals, because, you know, along with guitar, I sing, so especially from the vocals, you know, it's funny, all the years I've listened to them, I would have, you know, that's something that maybe just went over my head, but absolutely, Michael Stipe, his vocals very similar in the higher range, the more tenor, as opposed to what we had sans Kurt Cobain,
yeah.
or what we had in the, you know, early 90s with Eddie Vedder, Jerry Cantrell, Alice in Chains, all those guys. It was more of a baritone.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
yeah, for sure.
Yeah. I could definitely see that. If Pearl Jam, specifically Vitalogy and REM, had a baby, throwing copper right there.
And would that artwork work? I don't know. I can't try and figure
out. Oh my God, that's interesting. You know, and funny, I went to Scotland over Christmas break, took the family there. So the fact that this is done by a Scottish, I believe that's what it was from, a Scottish painter. I have to dive more into that on my own.
I looked at it and like, it recently sold for like some absurd amount of money. And I was like, oh, look at that. Oh my gosh. Glad that guy made some bank off of it. That's good.
Oh,
that's
good.
So
going through the album, you know, I listened to a lot of it recently. Look, I'm when I knew I was doing this, and again, super stoked to be on doing this.
Yeah.
This is like the highlight of my 2024 so far, not gonna lie. Hey, so Damn It, Otter Creek, track one. I listened to it a lot more recently. It's an intro track, right?
Yeah.
I maybe wouldn't have had it at 4 minutes. It's a long track. It reminds me of something that would have been cool at the beginning of an opening scene of a show like maybe True Detective, something like that. It builds. It's a really cool. It's a well done song. I'm more of a first track needs to kind of grab you by the shoulders and get you going. But it's not a bad song. It's not a bad track. Definitely something when I was 13, I wasn't jamming out to, because again, I mentioned I wanted to listen to Selling the Drama.
Right.
And then, you know, again, you have that one, and definitely Selling the Drama fits right into that, you know, 90s alt-rock sound, upbeat song, real catchy, three or four chords at the most, catchy chorus. And that's a theme you're going to see from live, especially this album. Some of the verses may be a little odd. I was reading a review about this album, and it said some of the lyrics were referred to as mystic gibberish.
Okay.
Because, you know, Ed Kowalczyk, very into Eastern religion, even melding with Western religion. A lot of his lyrics include some of that mysticism and Eastern views. But the choruses were always catchy. And I think you get that, especially in Selling the Drama.
Yeah.
So I think that was a good first single for them to release, for sure. Because it got me hooked.
I think what's interesting is that, like, from an album perspective, I'm with you. I want a first song to come, you know, kick the door down and let you know the album is there. But with you know, Selling the Drama and then I Alone, you've got these two, I think, really, really good singles. From an album perspective, I don't mind. In this case, I think it does work in the idea that you've got this first song that kind of just builds. It's almost this slow build to these two, you know, these kind of two hit singles that are coming next. So I'm with you. I want an album to kind of come kicking through the door, but I listened to this and I was like, wow, that's a really interesting choice. And it probably threw some kids off, but I, as a fan of somebody who I want to listen to a full album, I really do enjoy that experience. Like, even if by the end of some albums I'm done with it, I still want to do that. I thought it was I think it's a really interesting first choice. And I think it mostly works. You know, I would say a lot of people can't pull this off, but when you got such a strong second song and even third song, in my opinion, I think it actually works to kind of just build into the album. So it's an interesting choice. And I like that they took a chance on it. So
I think the musician in me now has appreciated the Damn It, Otter Creek, that first track, more.
Yeah.
I really like the guitar tone in it. And like I said, I think it, man, if I was a movie maker or a TV show maker, and that would be something that I would want in the background of like an opening kind of scene or whatever. It's it's got a good riff, just has a cool vibe to it. And then Selling the Drama. So funny thing about I Alone, they're in my opinion, I think it's actually their biggest single off this album besides Lightning Crashes, even though, again, my favorite song is going to be Selling the Drama. I Alone, we were talking about earlier, the different videos they were on, 120 minutes, all that.
Yeah.
Beavis and Butthead, famous cartoon from MTV.
Yeah.
That's SNL recently did a funny skit involving them. I don't know if you've seen it. It's quite humorous. So for those that know, Beavis and Butthead, cartoon and TV. So when they started not playing music as much.
Yeah.
But one of the skits they did was they would watch a video and they would make fun of it while they're sitting on their animated couch. And I Alone was one of the videos because it is a very, I'm not going to lie, odd, unique, very cheaply made video. It's totally. The band on a sound stage. I mean, heck, the drummer, I don't think he's just running around singing because he's not even playing a drum set.
Yep.
The lead singer was in between hairdos. He used to have really long hair and then he shaved it all off with the ponytail and finally went straight bald like yours truly. I mean, it's a good song. It's a great song.
Yes. Again,
three or four chords, but that video it's like, man, did they pocket the rest of the money and go get pizza or something? I mean, holy cow, what are we doing here?
Yeah. I watched it this week and I was like, oh, they either got no money from their record company or somebody hosed them on this. Cause oh my gosh, it looks like four high school kids who are like, oh, I don't know, what should we do? This is the best they could come up with. It's crazy.
And the drummer's like, you know, Talladega Nights, you know, not knowing what to do with his hands. Like, I don't know what to do. I don't have a drum kit. I'm just going to run around with the singer.
Right.
Sing. I don't even sing vocals, but I'm just going
to
sing.
It would have made so much more sense to take the bass guitar and the guitar player's instruments away too. Just have all four of them be there doing nothing.
Yeah.
Instead of having the one guy has nothing to do. It's a riot to watch. Cause you're right. It's a great song. But it's just a riot to watch that video.
Yeah.
The greatest of teachers won't hesitate to leave you there by yourself, chained to pain. Yeah, I alone love you. I alone tell you. I alone love you. There is nothing but this. I alone love you. I alone tell you.
Yes, and I'm a huge fan of this album, but they deserve to get roasted a little by our animated buddies, Beavis and Butthead, on that one.
Oh, man, that's funny.
So the next track, Iris, you know, this is where I would say Iris, and there's about four other songs that really have the same kind of driving drum kick to it. The drums really drive that song, and the most famous song called Iris is by a different band from Buffalo, New York,
yeah.
Goo Goo Dolls. That's a different album for a later day. But this song, again, interesting lyrics in the verses. You're like, what is this guy talking about? And then the chorus is just, I mean, it is a catchy chorus.
Yeah.
Driving drums, driving guitar. It's a song you want to listen to on a nice sunny day when you're driving with the windows down. I mean, it's just a good, solid song. So, again, another interesting one. And then Lightning, if we're going in order, Lightning Crash is obviously the biggest hit.
Yeah.
I was reading an old interview by the lead singer today. So, again, the music video ties in some with the lyrics, but gives the wrong perception. So actually, Ed Kowalczyk wrote this song for a high school classmate of his that died in a car accident.
Yep.
So what he wrote was a song kind of about the dichotomy of, in a hospital setting, a life being lost and people mourning that, especially at a young age, and then simultaneously someone in another wing of the hospital giving birth to a new life. And that's where the death and the baby being born and all that ties in together. People thought that it was a long time because of the video that it was a song about infant loss or something like that. And he said, no, it's actually about just, you know, the full circle of life, bring Lion King into the circle of life. But, you know, loss of life in the same under the same roof as, you know, the welcoming of life. So and then again, Lightning Crashes. I mean, holy cow, you can go into any bar, anyone playing a cover, whatever. Again, yours truly does that and throw out some Lightning Crashes and the crowd singing it. So
yeah.
that single, when that got released, that thing broke the radio. If internet would have been running on more than the AOL telephone line at the time, that thing would have broken the internet, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Because of that song just crushed it.
I can feel it.
I know it's a basic take, but that is my favorite song off this album. I know it's a bit basic, but I would argue that's one of the best. That's a top 10 alt rock song from the 90s. I really think it's, and I really like a lot of alt rock songs, but that's a pretty amazing song. I really love it. And again, I know it's a bit of a basic take, but man alive, I think that song just.
Song's good, the song's good. Yeah. You know, yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. And another thing, again, this is maybe me being a gatekeeper as a musician, a bit of a purist, but I like a song that you can play in different settings and it still sounds good. And I'm sad they never released it, but they did an MTV Unplugged, which, man, I wish they still did that. I think everyone could probably agree Nirvana's Unplugged is the biggest selling one, the most notorious one, the best one. But holy cow, Live did an Unplugged, and you can find it on the YouTubes out there. And before that, there was this thing called LimeWire Kids. That's how you got viruses. But holy cow, they're an Unplugged version of Lightning Crashes. Goosebumps.
Yeah.
So good. So good.
Yeah.
So yes, solid song. That song will be sung and talked about even when our kids are doing these podcasts. So it's a solid song for sure.
For sure.
Yeah, going into you know, some of the other songs, you got Top and then All Over You. Again, catchy choruses. That's what you get here with them. Driving drums, you know, this is kind of what harkens back to me to the, like you mentioned, even the REM or the Pearl Jam Vitalogy, just out of nowhere, these up-tempo driving songs that you're kind of like, I don't get what they're doing here, but the chorus is catchy, so you're going to listen to it. And every time I would play the CD, I'm like, well, I'm listening to the songs. The chorus is good. So,
yeah. Especially All Over You, and which ended up being a single as well. I think the chorus just wails on that one. And this is where they kind of start to play with a bit of that quiet, loud stuff that, you know, the Pixies kind of introduced. And All Over You, I think, is actually probably the most underrated song on this album, in my opinion. I think it's a really, really kind of almost forgotten single off this album, in my opinion, because I think it's great.
No, that's a great take. And as you mentioned that, one of my best friends from the band I was in, his name's Adam Johnson. I'll show this with him as well. he lives in the Kentucky, Indiana area now. He still does music. He plays bass in his in a church worship band.
Okay.
Bass player. So he, because of him and our relationship, I became someone who would appreciate a good bass line. All Over You, if you put the headphones on and want to focus to a bass line, there's a lot of good ones in this album, but holy cow, All Over You is a really good one. It just has this doom, 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 doom. It's really good. So that bass riff and that song, super good. I do like that. That's that one thing that stood out for me from that song.
For sure.
And then you have, look, I forgot who I was reading, another recent interview, but people talking about filler songs, right? Look, bands and artists have them because not every song can be a hit, right? Here's where you get some of these. Yeah. Like, you have Poop Town. I'm not going to say what the word is, but you have Poop Town. Again, actually, if you listen to the song, catchy chorus.
Yeah.
Cool driving drums. I like the guitar tone. I don't know why he's talking about whatever hometown he's talking about. I like my hometowns. I have a few. So don't know what Ed's over here talking about, but interesting song. You know, I would say the next even few songs are kind of like, hey, did you just need some stuff for the album? Because again, you can almost combine some of these same, very similar driving songs, driving drums, something that's going to maybe play well live in a concert, but on the recording, like, hey, what are you talking about here?
I kind of agree. This is where, and again, if you're a regular listener to this show, I think everything's too long, but that's me because the punk rock kid in me. But like, yeah, I can, the S-Town, if it wasn't for the country opening, like that's probably a bad explanation of it. Again, I'm no musician, but like, outside of the opening, I'm down with the rest of that song. TBD is, I think that one's fine. And, you know, if you gotta fill out the track list a little, that's okay. Otherwise, it does get potentially too short. There are a couple. Stage and Waitress don't work for me. My guess is some people really love Waitress, the kind of the wah-wah guitar, and I don't know if that's right, and the whistling probably works for some people. It just didn't work for me.
That's your B-sides fans right there.
Yeah, if I'm being honest. Yeah. But, you know, so I understand why they're there. They just do it less for me. I could potentially cut a couple of those three, and I'd be okay. But, you know, I also feel like this is potentially, I don't know, did they recognize they had a hit here with a couple of these songs? And was like, well, let's get it all on here if we got stuff to put out there. Cause, you know, I mean, it makes sense to. And in the CD age, an hour for an album, not crazy talk at all. So,
I mean, yeah, again, they got 14 tracks.
Yeah.
Nowadays you know, people are putting out with Spotify and all that, you know, you're putting out a couple tracks here and there cause you know, people piecemeal what they want to listen to.
Yeah.
So yeah, I agree with you. I ought to cut a couple of these. Again, TBD, Stage, Waitress, you could almost, I mean, shoot, like you mentioned, the country opening. I like country music. Poop Town could have almost been two different songs.
Yeah.
You take the verse version of it, you make a song, you take the chorus version, you make a separate song, and they're both catchy songs because I didn't mind the you know, the riffs and the so forth from the country side of it, but putting it together, I was kind of like, I don't know what they're doing here.
Yeah.
It's catchy. I'll listen to it, but nothing I'm going to say, ooh, can't wait to hear this song, put it on repeat.
Right.
So, same thing with those next few ones. Getting Down to Pillar of Davidson, I love the last two tracks. I could have done without Horse.
Yeah.
I love the last two tracks. Honestly, I would have almost flipped them. But again,
totally.
I'm not the guy from Talking Heads, but I would have almost flipped them. White Discussion, I'll be honest, I almost forget it was a single.
Yeah.
Until you mentioned that in the pre-production notes. I was like, oh yeah, that was a single.
Yeah.
Holy cow. I forget it was. It's not a bad song.
No,
I like
not
it.
At all.
I'll jam out to it. What I love about Pillar of Davidson is especially towards, I want to say it's like the last time they do the chorus. There's Ed Kowalczyk singing it in a round.
Mm.
He is singing the chorus, and then he's bringing in a different chorus. And then the production, he's singing it together. The chord progression they're using, the very high harmonies he's done in the background. I mean, a very well-produced song. Can't tell you what the heck he's singing about, but the production and the musicianship and the vocals from it, it's a really well-done song. It might be the best produced song on the album. Maybe not the best song, but as far as production value, I think it's the best produced song on the album. There's a lot of moving parts,
and
I think they did a very good job on it. That's one I always listen to, and I'll be honest, sometimes I just skip to the last half of it.
Yeah.
Because it does start very slow, but it ends very strongly, especially when he's singing in the round. That's really good. And again, White Discussion, good. Armchair quarterback in this, I'd have probably flipped them.
I think that's a great take. I think you flip those because I'm a big fan of closing tracks. I want a closing track on an album, and I want it to. I like when a closing track feels epic, and I think Pillar of Davidson would be a great closing track. It's going to feel epic. I love the way it builds. I don't mind that it was like 6.5 minutes. I'm not looking at it. Like,
oh yeah, it's a long one.
It's a long one. And I'm totally, you know, again, a punk rock guy. I'm totally down for the 6.5 minute song if you make it worth it. And that song's totally worth it. Totally worth it.
Especially when I finish it. And hey, I get you at the punk rock. I mean, I mentioned earlier, got into MXPX at a young age, so I'm all... Hey, side note, Scalaluya, one of my first concerts. It's the first concert I went to on my own when I lived in Waco. We drove to Dallas. It was Insiders, Five Iron Frenzy, and OC Supertones.
Yeah.
Some rundown shack in Dallas. It was awesome. But no, I get you. Like, you know, sometimes, you know, it's got to be a solid song to keep my attention for more than 5 minutes. And Pillar of Davidson really does that.
Yeah.
So, no, I would definitely flip that. But overall, it's an amazing album. It's a staple, in my opinion, because while they went on to not release maybe as many hits, follow-up album to this. And here's something else you mentioned earlier. You know, a lot of people don't realize this was not their debut.
Yeah.
A lot of bands in the 90s, their debut was not their hit. Oasis, second album.
Yep.
What's Story Morning Glory? Hit. Nirvana, Nevermind. Arguably the biggest album in the 90s.
Yep.
Second album. shoot, Green Day, Dookie, third album.
Yep.
And so many other bands that their big album was their second or the third one. This is, again, in that same vein. They had, what, Lakini Shoes, the next album, had Turn My Head. That was a pretty big hit. And then after that, they had an album, there's a single called Dolphins Cry. Funny side story, they did a tour for that album with Counting Crows, who I love Counting Crows. I would have never seen those two bands together,
yeah,
if I'm being honest.
That's an odd mix.
That's a very odd pairing. I love both bands. I don't think I would have ever put them on a bill together.
Yeah.
Completely different. But this album is definitely a staple of that 90s alt-rock, that post-West Coast, Pacific Northwest grunge, but still moving to alternative sound. I mean, it was only released in 94. Again, a single that, in my opinion, will still be one of those top 100 singles when the dust settles 100 years from now in the alt-rock landscape. They did a reissue of it on vinyl, and me being 42 years old, I like collecting vinyl these days. So that's definitely something I celebrate in my vinyl collection. So yeah. Definitely a staple in my formative years as an alt-rock fan. Again, I have pretty much a big Venn diagram of I'm in the middle. I got my CCM, I got my punk rock, I got my secular alt rock, and I got my, by God, I got my 90s or my country, and I got my classic rock. It all circles into there, but this is definitely, if I was putting in my staples of what, you know, of what I was listening to, Throwing Copper for sure.
I really like that idea of the Venn diagram and kind of how like your music interest can, or your music life can kind of center around stuff. I often think about the idea that like at 90s alternative stuff is kind of where my music center is, and then it kind of builds out in like ways. And I know that's not the same as like the Venn diagram, but like it builds out and it starts to, you know, that 90s alt rock incorporated the punk rock and then the ska. And that's, for me, is where really a lot of my music is centered. So I really like that. And then that pushed me to like go back and find The Clash. And, you know, The Clash would become a really, really important band for me, because so many of the 90s punk rock bands reference The Clash as an important influence on them. So I really, really like that idea of a Venn diagram, or like even just like a where your musical interests are centered. I think that's a really, really cool idea when thinking about music. And I like that way of approaching it and kind of thinking it through. Are there other things that are in that Venn diagram for you? I know you mentioned a couple, but like just other, how far out does that reach in a lot of ways?
Man, it reaches out pretty far, especially the older I get. You know, there was a time when I had the longer hair and all that, and I was like, man, it's all about alt rock and punk and, you know, some Rich Mullins. And then, you know, I mellowed out. Man, I like everything. I could rock out to some Blink-182 as easy as I could to some Willie Nelson and Johnny Cash. Especially being a Texan and a singer-songwriter myself, if I were to get back and do music full-time again, that's kind of more the mode I'd like. And again, I appreciate the passion and the melodies and the hooks and the driving musicianship of punk, pop punk especially. I've seen Newfound Glory I don't know how many times. I've seen MXPX. I've met Mike Carrera multiple times. Listen to his podcast as well. Again, mentioned earlier, I've seen Five Iron Frenzy and love the ska stuff. Man, something about a person and their guitar and just what's pouring out of their heart.
Yeah.
That the singer-songwriter stuff. And you get a lot of that in, not only in country, but again, hear me being a purist, there's something called Red Dirt or Texas Country that it's just, there's got a different flavor to it.
Yeah.
So I think the older I've gotten, the more I've splintered out with that, especially people I've played with. We can talk later before we sign off, but definitely want to throw out some names of people if you like different genres of music who you should check out. But they've all influenced me, right?
Yeah.
In some form or fashion, whether maybe I still pull from my lyric writing of a Rich Mullins or, you know, your favorite Jars of Clay. but I'll take maybe the musical stylings of maybe more of a singer-songwriter, like a guy named William Clark Green, who's an East Texas singer-songwriter, country musician, and I really like kind of his musicianship. So it has definitely grown as I've gotten older, but the foundation, again, when I think about back to Kevin, that fledgling musician and music lover, I'm still 12 years old, 13 years old, and I'm jamming out to alt-rock stuff
with
Rich Mullins in the bank. So I mean, but yeah, that alt rock stuff's definitely, that's the foundation my music all stands on for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny to throw the Rich Mullins thing out for a while. Because my youth pastor introduced me to Petra. And so, like, I was into it. You know, for me, it was like this eye-opening thing that there was these Christian rock things. Petra was a pretty fleeting fad for me. I know people love him, and that I think it's great that people still love him. And I can still jam a couple of those albums, and clearly super talented. But at one point, I feel like my favorite two bands were Petra and Green Day. So I can relate to the, like, alt rock and Rich Mullins. Like, it just, you know, kind of, do these things start to go together? Maybe not, but that's okay. There's no problem here. So yeah.
So for sure, no. I celebrated the Dookie album as much as I loved MXPX's On the Cover. That, you know, their version of Summer 69 is still up there. And so, yeah.
Yeah.
Them, Slick Shoes, all those guys, solid stuff. So, no, I'm with you on that.
Well, and some of us are still rocking the long hair. We just have it back.
Oh, man, look at that. Yeah. Nope, I'm bald.
Yeah, mine.
The DNA got me.
Down past my shoulders if I don't keep it up. I keep it up at most days, but hidden behind.
I was in my mid-20s, mid to late 20s, actually a platoon leader in Iraq, and my hair started running away from me.
So. Oh, I couldn't get away with this hair, could I, in any sort of military service? Or the beard, I'd be in trouble. So
The DNA got me. It's all good, though.
The flat feet would get me. That would. That's one of my claim to fames is when I realized I maybe had some foot problems in my late 20s, I went into a doctor, and he's like, oh, yeah. You have the flattest feet I've ever seen. Can I take pictures of your feet and send them to my colleagues? And I thought, this is not good. This is not what I wanted out of my late 20s.
Exactly. You're going to be in a presentation, but not the good kind.
Look at this guy. This is messed up.
Yeah, look at this. Exactly. What you don't want to be.
Well, I thanks so much for coming on the show and being a part of this. It's always better to talk to people. It's just hard to produce on a regular basis. So you know, where can people find you if they want to follow you on social media of any sorts? And then you mentioned a couple artists. So if there's people that you think people should go check out, especially people you've played with, or you know, what are some of those? I'd love to hear kind of some of those. And so where can we find you? And then where can, if there's other people that should be checked out that are maybe lesser known, are there any of those? I'd love to hear them.
Absolutely. So let's see. Sorry, pulling up my socials here. On my Instagram is probably the best one. It's going to be Kevin B. Duke. You find that on my Instagram. I'll share whenever I'm playing in DFW or really anywhere throughout Texas. I know on the Twitters, we were talking about it earlier. Because I have my job one, because I'm a teacher and a coach on the civilian side. I'm still in the Army Reserve, so let's see. Oh, yeah, Duke_Nukem_TX. Sometimes I get a little passionate about college sports there, so if you're a UT or a TCU fan, you may not like that. I'm sorry. My Instagram, that's good. That's good to go. It's pretty much all family and music. But I'd love to throw some shout-outs to some of my buddies. You know, I still gig, but I do it kind of like you do the podcast. It's for fun.
Yeah.
The extra money's fine. I enjoy playing. I also play worship at my church, okay. And that's fun. I enjoy doing that at Irving Bible Church in the DFW area. But I have friends that still, I mean, they're in the trenches and they do this full time. So a friend of mine, Aaron Konzelman, he and his wife are in a group called the Union Revival. Cool thing about Aaron, he was actually on The Voice a few years ago. He ended up making it to Team Blake. Amazing songwriter and vocalist. A guy who was the bass player in my band for a little while. I mentioned a different bass player, but this guy, he goes by John Dempsey on Spotify. Check him out if you like singer-songwriter stuff, Three Chords in the Truth, more of a Texas red, if you want that Texas red dirt style, he does it, but love him. And I mentioned playing guitar in Iraq back in the day. I don't think he still plays anymore, but I was a platoon leader. My guy who was my troop commander, I was a lieutenant, he was a captain at the time. He was in a Texas country band called the War Horses. They released a couple albums on Spotify. I don't think he gigs anymore, unfortunately. Really good albums. If you like that genre and that style, check out the War Horses on Spotify. Give it a spin. He's got college funds to pay for now, so, you know, he'll take those fractions of a penny. You give it a spin, you know, he'd appreciate it. But other than that, yeah, I love to connect with people, especially when it comes to music. I love conversing about it. Again, connections I would have never made. Like, REM, we talked about it earlier. Duh, what an obvious, you know, connection.
Yeah.
And that's so cool. I totally see it now, especially them not being geographically aligned with the West Coast at all, too. Just so many similarities. And then REM being, you know, already having, you know, a foundation from the 80s and so forth. So,
yeah.
No, I love being able to connect on social media and so forth with this. And again, what a great idea. The album anniversary. I mean, holy cow. Just you forget about albums coming out. And especially celebrating 30 years in 94 or 2024. And we kind of talked about all the big ones. And I'm actually seeing Hooting the Blowfish cracked review in album anniversary. They're going on tour and we already have tickets to it. They'll be playing in Dallas in June, them, Edwin McCain and Collective Soul. So I'm excited about that.
Yeah. The whole idea is like, I realized like I've got a lot of albums and you just get caught up listening to certain things. And I was like, oh, I haven't listened to this in a while. And so that became like, I say it every week on the regular show, like it just started with a couple of my favorites because I wanted that excuse to be like, and right now I feel like there's so much new music. There's so much music around. Like you could discover a new band every day of the week or every day of the year and you still wouldn't run out. I mean, people all the time are like, oh, have you checked this band out? And you're like, no, because I just can't keep up. And so like for me, that's what it became. And I like the idea of like being able to look back and make these connections because I'm sure there are bands that think about Lightning Crashes as a template for a hit song and then do something like that. I like the idea that, you know, radio, this is a Radiohead talks about they just wanted to be like REM and REM was trying to just be like somebody else. And like I love those connections. And so that I'm tend to look back more than I look forward at new music in a lot of ways, but it definitely, that's where the idea came from. Was just like, oh yeah, it's a good excuse to go back and listen to an album that, you know, you may not spin as much because there's so much music out there and it's a good excuse to, oh yeah, it's time to listen to this. I haven't listened to it in a while. So that's the whole idea behind it. And I'm glad people seem to like it enough. So that's fun.
Oh yeah, no, love it. Look forward to it every day, every week. The posts and just talking about CDs. Like the convenience of streaming is great, but I've kept all my old CDs and CD binders, and it's digital music, right? It sounds the same, but the artwork and the packaging, that's so cool. And even you know, my daughters who are younger will pull out some of the old. They even like the CDs I made when I was in a band, and they look at that. Like, hey, Daddy had hair once. I promise you, I wasn't lying. So,
I got stacks of CDs around, sitting around all around me. I still, you know, and I've loaded it all onto YouTube Music for the convenience of it. But I mean, I still have CDs, and I keep CDs in my car, and I'm thankful my car still has a CD player. Our van doesn't anymore, which drives me a little nuts. But I love being like, am I listening to on this drive to? CVS, I'm throwing this in, it's like there's something great about that physical media. Totally. I totally love it.
No, I got a new truck a few months ago. I got a Tundra, which I miss having a truck. No CD player, but we kept my old Grand Cherokee, which does have a CD player. So we have two CD players in the whole house. I bought a cheap one off Amazon, and by God, my Grand Cherokee has one as well.
Yeah, that's totally it. Yeah. I gotta convince the kids. I just run it through my DVD player upstairs.
There you go.
It's not a nice sound system by any means, but it's like, yeah, that'll do if I want to play something upstairs. Yeah, so
that'll work. Yeah, that'll work. That'll get it done.
Well, awesome, man. Thanks so much for joining me. It was great to talk. I probably wouldn't have gone as in depth into this album on the regular show. So I love the excuse to, for me, it was a good experience of really taking a deeper dive. So I'm glad you threw it out there and it was great to talk.
Yeah, Sam, I'm very glad we finally got to connect. And no, this was exciting. I really enjoyed doing this. Great concept. I know you give an extra amount of your time to do this. Keep doing it. It's a great idea, and I hope it continues to grow. I'll share it as much as I can. And no, what a great idea. I love this, man.
Thanks. I'm glad people like it. Once again, I just want to say thanks to Kevin for joining me. It was great to have him on the show. If you're listening and you're interested in joining the show to talk about an album you love, you can find me on Twitter at CalebTheSpy. I'm also on Instagram at CalebTheSpy with underscores in between each word. Or you can email me at CalebTheSpyPodcasts@gmail.com. The music at the beginning and the end of the show is the instrumental version of Sing It Out at Street Level by Peg and the Rejected, which is the Dingies focused on ska tunes. you should check out The Dingies and Peg and the Rejected. Let me know what you think. What did we get right? What did we get wrong? Please subscribe and share the podcast. If you're so inclined, leave a rating or review. I've heard it's the most effective way to spread the word about podcasts. And like I say every show, thank you if you engage with me at all on social media. I put a lot of time and energy into setting up the daily posts, so seeing people get excited to revisit or discover older albums is always a thrill, or occasionally they end up on my podcast. Thanks again. We'll talk to you soon.